In the last video, we saw that if Alice and Bob have a payment channel, it only makes it easier for them to send money between themselves. If Alice wants to send money to Charlie and doesn't want to set up a payment channel between them, then we have an issue here. What we can do instead is set up a network of payment channels. As long as Alice is connected to Charlie somehow in the network, then she can send him money. This is an example of what a payment channel network would look like. Alice, on the left side of the network here, is able to send money to Charlie on the right side of the network through this hypothetical payment channel network, where her payment first goes through Bob, then Eve, then finally to Charlie. The main problem we have to address here is that of security. How do we ensure that capital is being transferred along the payment channel network? Well, thankfully, with just some small additions on top of our HTLC construction, we can trustlessly send money across a network of payment channels governed by HTLCs. And that was the innovation of the Lightning Network paper, titled The Bitcoin Lightning Network, Scalable Off-Chain Instant Payments, written by Joseph Poon and Thaddeus Dryja in early 2016. So what exactly are the scalability benefits of the Lightning Network? Well, if we assume that there's enough capital in payment channels, then we can pretty much make payments instantly. We don't have to wait for confirmation times on the main blockchain, since we're doing everything off-chain. Transactions could occur as fast as communication delay across the network, since, as we saw earlier, if Alice wants to transact with Charlie, her transaction might have to go through several hops through other payment channels in order to go through. And since we're only using the main Bitcoin blockchain as an arbiter to settle disputes and to close out payment channels, we reduce the load on the main bottleneck, the main Bitcoin blockchain. So, there would be far fewer transactions on the blockchain. What this means is that instead of 3 transactions per second that was calculated in the previous section, the Bitcoin network could potentially support tens of thousands of transactions per second. Since we're delegating payments to simple bookkeeping that's done in each payment channel, we avoid the main bottleneck, the Bitcoin blockchain. And in practice, depending on the choice of when and between which nodes to have payment channels, we could keep a very high percentage of transactions, upwards of 99%, off-chain. And keeping transactions off-chain not only increases the scalability of the network as a whole, but it also has some nice outcomes for the users as well. First of all, transactions would be very fast, meaning that it's now feasible for me to get a coffee and not wait 60 minutes for confirmations. Also, Lightning Network transaction fees would be several orders of magnitude cheaper than that of the normal Bitcoin network, since we'd be doing everything off-chain. And we'd only have to pay more expensive fees upon opening and closing a payment channel, since these would be the actual transactions on the Bitcoin blockchain. And in terms of speed, we're only really limited by the packet transfer overhead, and that's not really an issue here since it's very fast. So instead of 3 TPS, or 6 or 10 with incremental changes, we could literally have tens of thousands of TPS with the Lightning Network. As great as the Lightning Network sounds, of course we have some immediate issues we have to consider. First of all, payment channels could be very expensive to operate. We identified earlier that payment channels could be a problem if most payments occur in only a single direction. For example, if Alice buys a coffee from Bob every morning, but Bob never pays Alice for anything. In these cases, nodes would need to keep very large amounts of capital locked up in payment channels to avoid running out of capital in the payment channel and having to close it and open a new one with more capital. There's also a tendency to strong centralization. Only nodes with significant capital can afford to hold payment channels for long, since they can afford to allocate a lot of capital to each payment channel. Larger payment channels would get settled less often on the main blockchain, meaning that they could offer lower transaction fees. Other users would see this and want to use these payment channels to avoid fees. And so, these payment channels controlled by more capital would get a disproportionate amount of traffic. And finally, there's the realization that less capital is required with less nodes on the network. So there's a tendency towards a hub-and-spoke network topology, perhaps with large banks opening up many payment channels to other banks or brokers, themselves with a lot of capital. And from the perspective of Bitcoin's values of decentralization, this is probably not so good for the politically minded. Of course, the idea of payment channel networks isn't limited to just the Lightning Network for Bitcoin. There's also a comparable technology for Ethereum, called Raiden. The idea is mainly the same, to support a network of payment channels, but there are some implementation differences, especially given the differences between Bitcoin and Ethereum anyways. The most basic differences to spot are that Raiden would be implemented as a smart contract, and Raiden nodes in the Ethereum network would allow for ERC-20 compliant token transfers between users.